Dr. James Peach, thank you so much for joining me here today on New Mexico in Focus.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Now, I want to talk about grocery prices and something that we've all experienced, seemingly endless increase at grocery chains around the state. I just wanted to establish right off the bat before we get into specifics, we are crazy, right? Prices are continuing to go up even now.
Yes. In fact, this morning there was a new release of the Consumer Price Index. Surprisingly, food was not one of the major items that was increasing. It was mainly gasoline, transportation, and housing.
Okay.
Food is relatively flat.
That's something that I want to get into in terms of pricing versus inflation, but let's start with inflation specifically. We know it's down from its highs a couple years ago, but prices are still high. So can you explain exactly what inflation is first and what influences that number that we see right around 3% right now?
Yes. The easiest way to look at it is to think of a shopping cart, and you go into the grocery store and you buy 15 or 20 items, and you come back, you know the price of that basket. You come back a month or a year later, you buy exactly those same items again and see whether the price has gone up or down. If it's gone up, that would be inflation. But add to the basket all of the other things we purchase, like shelter and transportation and entertainment, even barbershops and the like. And so it's a basket of goods, and inflation occurs when that basket of goods and services increases in price. It's not just one item.
Okay, and not just one industry either.
And not just one industry.
Understood. So with inflation cooling and focusing in on that one specific industry of grocery prices right now, broadly speaking, what factors impact those prices at the grocery store, even when inflation is dropping?
It's not an easy question to answer because there are multiple things.
Okay.
For farm produce, for example, when energy prices increase, those costs farmer have to be passed along to the consumer. So energy is a big deal in the agricultural industry. So is the structure of the retail industry. And by that, I mean whether or not big chains dominate in a particular area. There are some advantages, actually, of having large grocery stores. The overhead is spread over a lot more customers and a lot more stuff. The typical grocery store these days has 40 or 50,000 items in the store. And that's hard to do in a small store.
Now, within a grocery store, are there any specific items, like we've seen the fluctuation of egg prices, for example. How do those more volatile items influence the overall pricing within a grocery store, or is it mostly separate?
It's separate.
Okay.
When the grocery store sets the price of eggs, it does so based on the wholesale price that it's paying, not on the price of some other commodity. Eggs are an interesting example. I bought some at the store just 2 days ago. And yes, they cost me more than they did 5 years ago, but less than they did a couple of years ago.
Yeah, yep. I know we've all experienced that. Now, a report from Health Advisor shows that New Mexico ranks sixth in the nation with the highest weekly average grocery bill of more than $286 per average household in the state. That's in the top 10 for the country on average. But why are grocery trips here around $15 more expensive than, say, a neighboring state like Arizona?
In part, because we have a smaller population base. And so we have many grocery stores that are in very small communities, and they can't take advantage of buying in bulk. They can't stock what a big store can stock. And the overhead, you have to have a store manager, you have to pay rent, you have to pay the electric bill, and it's spread over a smaller number of customers.
You talk about larger grocery chains versus smaller grocery chains. We've heard in the news recently a proposed merger between the two largest grocery chains in the country. That's Kroger and Albertsons. Kroger, obviously, Smith's here in New Mexico for the most part. Attorney General Raul Torres is opposed to that merger. Several other attorneys general across the country are too. Can you explain the reasons why attorneys general would be opposed to a merger like this, and what should consumers think about it? How does it affect people like you and me?
The reason that attorneys general oppose mergers like that very frequently is because it reduces competition.
Okay.
And competition is something that typically results in lower prices for consumers. So if you have two very large firms merging, the potential is there to have more market power and the ability to raise prices. It would not create a monopoly. Adam Smith, 2.5 centuries ago, warned us about monopoly and monopoly prices. And he said, a monopoly price is the highest price that can be got. And the competition in terms of price was a very good thing. That's why they opposed it.
Okay. In terms of, from the industry's perspective, what is the benefit for these two chains to create this merger, and what should we think about that?
Typically, in a merger like that, they can eliminate some management positions.
Okay.
They can combine to put more leverage on their suppliers, lower prices given to them. That's not necessarily passed along to the consumer, and that's what attorney generals get upset about.
Okay.
They don't need two HR departments. They don't need two everything to run at a large firm, so they can get rid of a lot of that stuff. And so they talk about efficiencies due to the merger. Problem is that doesn't always benefit the consumer.
Now, also according to that report that I mentioned earlier from Health Advisor, Hispanic and Latino Americans are spending the most each week on groceries on average. Why is that demographic being hurt so much by these price increases?
In part, from where they live.
Okay.
In smaller communities, that you can often find communities that are predominantly Hispanic or Latino in New Mexico, in part because neighborhoods in large cities are not served well by the distribution of grocery stores. It is unlikely, I think, that it is because of the particular market basket of goods that Hispanics and Latinos purchase.
Okay. Now, who else in New Mexico is bearing the brunt of these high prices the most? Is it even across the board?
No, it's not even. People on fixed incomes suffer the most from inflation in general, including grocery prices. So that would include most retirees who get a fixed amount of money every month. And if the prices go up, that money buys less. Typically, not always, but typically those on fixed income don't have high incomes.
This might not be perfectly your area of expertise, but what can New Mexicans do to help stretch their dollars a little bit further when they do make it out to the store?
Shop wisely. Often, a generic brand at the grocery store is of equal quality to the well-known brand. Buy generic brand, buy in bulk when possible, because that's generally cheaper. It is cheaper, for example, to buy a 25-pound sack of flour than it is to buy a 4-pound sack of flour.
Gotcha. Now, taking everything that we just talked about into account, should we expect grocery prices to keep climbing, stay flat, like you mentioned they kind of are right now, or is there any hope of them kind of leveling off to going down in the near future?
I think there's some hope that they will level out. But remember, we're talking about 40,000 different products on the market out there. I don't think there's much of a chance that grocery prices will go down much. Selected items might.
Well, Dr. James Peach, thank you so much for being here today on New Mexico in Focus.
Thank you, and good luck to you.